So Satan tempts Jesus in the desert. And mind you, this is after Jesus was baptized. So then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. So digging a little deeper into the notes, the time of testing showed that Jesus really was the Son of God, able to overcome the devil and his temptations. A person has not shown true obedience if he or she has never had an opportunity to disobey. We read in Deuteronomy 8:2 that God led Israel into the desert to humble and test them. God wanted to see whether or not his people would really obey him. We too will be tested. Because we know that testing will come, we should be alert and ready for it. Remember, your convictions are only strong if they hold up under pressure. The devil also called Satan tempted Eve in the Garden of Eden, and here he tempted Jesus in the desert. Satan is a fallen angel. He is real, not symbolic, and is constantly fighting against those who follow and obey God. Satan's temptations are real, and he is always trying to get us to live his way or our way, rather than God's way. Jesus will one day reign over all creation, but Satan tried to force his hand and get him to declare his kingship prematurely. If Jesus had given in his mission on earth to die for our sins and give us the opportunity to have eternal life, would have been lost. When temptations seem especially strong, or when you think you can rationalize giving in, consider whether Satan may be trying to block God's purposes for your life or for someone else's life. The temptation by the devil shows us that Jesus was human, and it gave Jesus the opportunity to reaffirm God's plan for his ministry. It also gives us an example to follow when we are tempted. Jesus' temptation was an important demonstration of his sinlessness. He would face temptation and not give in. Jesus was tempted by the devil, but he never sinned. Although we may feel dirty after being tempted, we should remember that temptation itself is not a sin. We sin when we give in and disobey God. Remembering this will help us turn away from the temptation. Jesus wasn't tempted inside the temple or at his baptism, but in the desert, where he was tired, alone, and hungry, and thus most vulnerable. The devil often tempts us when we are vulnerable, when we are under physical or emotional stress. For example, lonely, tired, weighing big decisions, faced with uncertainty. But he also likes to tempt us through our strengths, where we are most susceptible to pride. We must guard at all times against his attacks. The devil's temptations focused on three crucial areas: physical needs and desires, possessions and power, and pride. But Jesus did not give in. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 says that Jesus has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. He knows firsthand what we are experiencing, and he is willing and able to help us in our struggles. When you are tempted, turn to him for strength. Jesus was hungry and weak after fasting for 40 days, but he chose not to use his divine power to satisfy his natural desire for food. Food, hunger, and eating are good, but the timing was wrong. Jesus was in the desert to fast, not to eat, and because Jesus had given up the unlimited, independent use of his divine power in order to experience humanity fully, he wouldn't use his power to change the stones to bread. We also may be tempted to satisfy a perfectly normal desire in a wrong way or at the wrong time. If we indulge in sex before marriage, or if we steal to get food, we are trying to satisfy God-given desires in wrong ways. Remember, many of your desires are normal and good, but God wants you to satisfy them in the right way at the right time. Jesus was able to resist all the devil's temptations because he not only knew scripture, but he also obeyed it. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17 says that God's word is a sword to use in spiritual combat. Knowing Bible verses is an important step in helping us resist the devil's attacks, but we must also obey the Bible. Note that Satan had memorized scripture, but he failed to obey it. Knowing and obeying the Bible helps us follow God's desires rather than the devil's. God is not our magician in the sky ready to perform on request. In response to Satan's temptations, Jesus said not to put God to a test. You may want to ask God to do something to prove his existence or his love for you. Jesus taught through a parable that people who don't believe what is written in the Bible won't believe even if someone were to come back from the dead to warn them. And you can refer to Luke chapter 16, verse 31 for that. God wants us to live by faith, not by magic. Don't try to manipulate God by asking for signs. The devil used scripture to try to convince Jesus to sin. Sometimes friends or associates will present attractive and convincing reasons why you should try something you know is wrong. They may even find Bible verses that seem to support their viewpoint. Study the Bible carefully, especially the broader context of specific verses, so that you understand God's principles for living and what he wants for your life. Only if you really understand what the whole Bible says will you be able to recognize errors of interpretation when people take verses out of context and twist them to say what they want them to say. Did the devil have the power to give Jesus the kingdoms of the world? Didn't God, the creator of the world, have control over these kingdoms? The devil may have been lying about his implied power, or he may have based his offer on this temporary control and free reign over the earth because of humanity's sinfulness. Jesus' temptation was to take the world as a political ruler right then without carrying out his plan to save the world from sin. Satan was trying to distort Jesus' perspective by making him focus on worldly power and not on God's plans. The devil offered the whole world to Jesus if Jesus would only bow down and worship him. Today, the devil offers us the world by trying to entice us with materialism and power. We can resist temptations the same way Jesus did. If you find yourself craving something that the world offers, quote Jesus' words to the devil, "Worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And then I just want to point out also, you know, that after Jesus resisted Satan three times, the devil left him, and then angels came and attended to him. And I just want to point out, you know, in Romans chapter 8, verse 17, you know, it states that we are co-heirs with Christ, inheriting in his glory, but we're also inheriting the suffering. So turn with me now to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 17. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. So, in the notes, it says there's a price for being identified with Jesus. Along with the great treasures, Paul mentions the suffering that Christians must face. What kinds of sufferings are we to endure? For first century believers, there was economic and social persecution, and some even faced death. We too must pay a price for following Jesus. In many parts of today's world, Christians face pressures just as severe as those faced by Christ's first followers. Even in countries where Christianity is tolerated or encouraged, Christians must not become complacent. To live as Jesus did, serving others, giving up one's own rights, resisting pressures to conform to the world, always exacts a price. Nothing we suffer, however, can compare to the great price that Jesus paid to save us. So there's a lot here in these scriptures. And, you know, I just want to go back to the devil's temptations. He focused on three areas: physical needs and desires, possessions and power, and pride. One of my friends actually said that somebody told her that as a Christian, that 80% of being a good Christian is a good night's sleep. And I feel like we can see that in these scriptures. You know, he was tired and hungry. I mean, and if you think about the term hangry, you know, when I'm hungry and cranky, I mean, that's not my best look. It's awful. And I feel like I'm not myself when that happens. And, you know, it's when we're most vulnerable that those temptations to sin are really hard to resist. And on the flip side, I feel like as Christians today, Satan really tempts us to pride. It's like, wow, Jesus went through these temptations and showed us how to resist them. It's so important for us to know our scripture, because the devil knows the scriptures and he twists them. And if we don't spend time in the scripture, we're setting the sword down. The sword that we could be slicing away and defeating and tearing down all these lies. So, you know, I mean, I feel strong and courageous in that I'm like, if this is what I need to defeat the enemy, I want to spend time in this. I want to spend time in it. I crave it because I need it. Because the devil, I'm telling you, he's so crafty with those lies. It makes me angry when I think about it, how crafty he is. Because there's always this grain of truth in there that gets me going, thinking, oh, you're right. And then I start to fall for it. The manipulations and the lies. Jesus said he's the father of lies. Satan, he called Satan the father of lies. So he's good at it. And we know from the Bible that he's, you know, to be of sober mind and to be alert and on guard, because the devil is looking for someone to devour, that he's on the prowl like a lion, looking for someone to devour. And I'm telling you, I mean, the temptations that he's come at me with, I mean, temptations of nobody loves you, nobody likes you, you wouldn't be missed, you should take your own life, you wouldn't be missed, the people that would miss you, oh, they'll get over it. Lies! Lies! They won't get over it! They won't get over it! It ruins people's lives! It destroys them! He not only wants to destroy the plans for our lives, but also the people around us. And when I think about it that way, it is very important that we love ourselves, Because the Bible tells us, Jesus said, God's greatest commands are to love God with all our heart, mind, and soul, and to love our neighbor as ourself. All the laws of the prophets depend on this. They're God's two greatest commands, and they're equally important. And if we don't love ourselves, then when we love our neighbor as ourselves, if we don't love ourselves that much, how much are we depriving our neighbor of that love? We need to love ourselves as our neighbors as well. Because not only does Satan want to destroy the plans for our lives and God's will and purpose for our lives, he wants to destroy it for everyone around us. And Christ's love, God's love, compels us that when God sent Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, that he died for all. He died for all of us. We know not everybody will follow Jesus. Some people will reject him to the bitter end. But it's Christ's love that compels us to want no one to perish, because the Bible tells us it's not God's will for anyone to perish. But he's given us free will to accept his son or reject him. There's no pleasure to be taken from loving a robot. He's given us free will to love him or to not love him. He's not forcing it on us. And his plans are better. His will, his plan is better.
Please subscribe to youtube.com/choicescoach. And if you would like to see more video content, please support me on Patreon. The link is at the top of my YouTube channel. Thank you.